CHBJ 1501 佛教在21世纪的社会功能及其修行观念，第四届中华国际佛学会议开幕典礼主题演说。是圣言。中华佛学研究所创办人。http://www.trips.edu.tw/chapter-html/chbj-15 中华佛学学报第十五期 ,P1年2月8, 民国91年，台北中华佛学研究所。http://www.trips.edu.tw Chung, Hua Buddhist Journal, No. 15, 2002 Taipei, The Chung, Hua Institute of Buddhist Studies ISSN 1017-7132佛教在二十一世纪的社会功能及其修行观念。第四届中华国际佛学会议开幕典礼主题演说。是圣言。中华佛学研究所创办人。P1。一、前言。自从1990年元月12、15日我们中华佛学研究所甲台北国家图书馆举办了第一届中华国际佛学会议以来，已历12个年头，当时拟定的永久主题是佛教传统与现代社会。在此原则下，以前三届也各选定了一个主题，分别是佛教伦理与现代社会、传统戒律与现代世界、人间净土与现代社会。每一届都有很多杰出的学者们发表了高水准的论文。这回是第四届，我们依旧要沿着永久主题的原则来讨论佛教与二十一世纪。我们邀请到了来自中华民国、中国大陆、泰国、英国、美国、印度、加拿大、日本、俄国、德国、南韩等11个国家地区，当今世界的优秀佛教学者共40多人，发表30多篇相关的精彩论文。我首先要在这里向诸位学者们致敬和致谢，因为你们诸位将为21世纪全人类的福祉提供卓越的研究成果及高明的建言。这回的大会有3个子题，分成3个领域，那就是一、佛教与修行；二、佛教与社会；三、佛教与资讯。每一个领域都将有好多篇专业的论文发表。我的这篇主题演说仅就佛教与修行、佛教与社会的2个项目，依据《阿含经》的观点做回顾与前瞻的探讨，用来向诸位善知识请教。至于第3个项目，则由路易士·兰卡斯特博士来给我们做另外一篇主题演说。二、佛教本来就重视社会关怀。宗教是社会现象的一环，佛教也不例外。虽在佛灭后已经过2500多年，佛教依旧在人类社会中担负着极其重要的任务。甚至可说，现代乃至未来的世界，愈来愈需要佛教的智慧和方法来解决人类的社会问题。接下来，我将是举5项社会议题，从《阿含经》的观点，说明佛教的立场及其可能提供的解决方法。P2。 一、人权平等。现代的社会必须建立在人权平等的基本要求上，此在古印度称为四种性的四大阶级社会中是不被承认的，但于佛说的阿含经中早已主张四性平等，例如中阿含经卷39梵志品，佛与梵志论说四性平等，一中阿含经卷59利品的一切至今，佛与波斯匿王论说四性问题，由王说出四性应平等的结论。二杂阿含经卷44有记云，汝莫问所生，但当问所行，克木未钻碎，亦能生于火。下见种性中，身坚固木泥。三，这是说下见的阶级中也有圣人出生。增益阿含经卷37有云，我法中有四种性，于我法中作沙门，不露前名，更作于字，犹如比四大江河，皆投于海而痛一味，更无余名。四长阿含经卷6小圆经记述佛云，若有人问汝谁种性，当答彼言，我是沙门，是种子也。五，意思是说种族阶级的信仰是不合理的，应该以塑形的道德和智慧的高低深浅论其成就，不当以出生的家族或种族的背景论其贵贱。所以凡在佛陀的团体中出了家的，便可舍却原有的种族阶级，一律称为沙门世子，纵然依旧在家学佛，也不以出生的种族阶级论其高下，而一律皆以所行的善法程度来做衡量。这就是打破不平等的阶级制度，将各种族群的人都置于同等的社会地位了。此在当时的印度社会应算是一种革命性的人权运动。 P3 2政教分离。政治与宗教分离是新时代的必然趋势，否则的话，由于政治体制与宗教结构的挂钩，会为政治人物带来操纵宗教群众的弊端，也会为宗教团体带来腐败及俗化的危机，往往会因了政治人物的私利而驱使宗教的群众发动宗教战争。正统的佛教徒是不会被卷入政治漩涡的。例如增益阿含经卷42洁净品中规定，比丘不得亲近国王，否则可能会有10种负面的问题发生，对比丘不利，也于佛教的团体有害。六中阿含经卷49大空经中规定，沙门不应论王、论贼、论斗阵等。七增益阿含经卷43善恶品中，佛对比丘们说，汝等莫称鸡王治国界，亦莫论王有胜劣。八，因为佛教是无国界的，不得党同伐异的，不得参与政治斗争的。不过佛教徒也不是不关心政治的良与治乱，若遇贤王良相，亦当适时给予谏言。例如中阿含经卷35的与世经，9长阿含经卷2的游行经，10增益阿含经卷34的七日品，11均举出治国的七法。 大致是主张王臣勤政爱民，以和合心意国事，人民彼此团结，上下和顺，尊重其素意见，不违礼度，法律清明，崇信宗教，供奉供养，以宗教来福国佑民，安定社会人心，由政治来治国保民，护持宗教。出家的佛教徒在任何国家都是爱国的，关心政治的，但不左右政治。至于在家佛教徒，不仅关心政治，也应参与政治，为不可利用教团的群众作为政治的工具。三、宗教宽容。文化多元与宗教的包容已是新文明的必然趋势。今日美国的强大起源于英国清教徒不容于保守的英国，而移民到了美洲新大陆。美国立国精神之一便是人民有宗教信仰的自由，保障了宗教的包容性与多样性。事实上，此在佛陀时代就已处处告诫弟子们，应当平等恭敬供养一切宗教的沙门婆罗门，例如《长阿含经》卷二的《游行经》，建议国王治国，当恭于宗庙，致敬鬼神，而与孝事父母敬顺师长并列。十二，在《增益阿含经》P 四卷三十四的七日品中，鼓励把止国人供养沙门婆罗门，成是礼敬犯行人。十三，也就是说，人人均应有宗教信仰和所供养成是的宗教师及修行者，但不一定非得信仰佛教不可。另于中阿含经卷三十二的优婆离经中，特别叙述一则动人的故事。十四，说有一位原本供奉尼间外道的居士，接受了佛陀的教化之后，准备不再让尼间外道师进他家门，也不打算供养原先的外道师了。佛陀知道了，却勉励他仍应如往常一样的供养，并且开示说：居士，我不如是说，当师与我，莫师与他，师与我弟子，莫师与他弟子。居士，师与一切，随心欢喜。居士，比尼坚等汝家长业所共尊敬，若其来者，汝当随力供养于彼。十五，佛教主张，只要是不违背人天善法的一切宗教，均应受到保护及尊重。只是一定要告诉大家，佛教虽也是以人天善法为基础，却不以人天善法为究竟。在这之上，尚有出离生死的解脱道，自觉觉他的菩萨道，成等正觉的无上菩提。佛教是求同存异的宗教，所以能够包容异文化，甚至运用异文化的优点来帮助佛法的推广，不像是若干一元论二分法的宗教，把异民族异文化的其他教派一律视为魔鬼，而认为必须予以歼灭，因此造成宗教与种族的世仇大敌，冤冤相报，杀伐不已。新世纪的地球村中，类似从1996年起统治阿富汗的神学士政权，像那样极端的回教一元论者，势必会被时代潮流孤立而失去生存的空间，否则人类社会的命运就要非常的悲惨了。四、社会福利。入世济世的菩萨精神 已是时代宗教的必走之路。事实上，自从佛陀成道之后，除了每年三个月的雨季是安居不外出之外，几乎每天都会率领弟子们到人间游化说法，关怀人间大众的疾苦，宣说脱苦之道，劝勉人间大众都应发心利益众生。除了在《增益阿含经》卷十一中有定光佛说了菩萨所行法，十六同经卷十九中有弥勒菩萨请示六波罗蜜法，十七杂阿含经卷二十六的六百六十七经及六百六十九经明载有四摄法。 P 五十八六度与四摄，一向被认为是大乘的菩萨法门，却在阿含经中已见到了。六度中的布施行是利他门，持戒行看似自利门，可是五戒被称为五大师，持戒行也含摄了菩萨的三句境界，那便也是利他门了。四摄法的布施、爱语、力行、同事，则全属于利他行的方便法。在阿含经中处处鼓励佛弟子们当行布施，这是佛教的社会福祉观，因为人类的知能和福报是不会相等的，生产的能力和经营的能力是不会相同的，尤其是个人的机遇也不会一样，自然而然的就会形成贫富的差距。若用什么制度来将财物平均分配，那是不公平的，也是不理智的。如果硬性规定下去，可能不是平均的富有，而是平均的贫穷了。解决贫富悬殊的社会现象，除了合理的经济制度，其最好的办法便是鼓励人人都乐意布施。布施哪些项目呢？增益阿含经卷二十七的协聚品有云：富有五施，令得大福，云何为五？一者造作圆观，二者造作灵树，三者造作桥梁，四者造作大船，五者与当来过去的人造作房舍住处。十九，这五个项目都是社会大众的公共设施，包括了造作公园及其建筑物、森林、桥梁、大船、旅社。这些在现代社会中多半已由政府负责建造了，但是尚有政府做不到的公益福利，均可比照着由民间大众布施，例如对流离失所的灾民、难民、贫病交迫、饥寒乡间的穷人、病患，均应伸出援手，施衣食，给医药，教他们谋生的方法和技巧，乃至例如于《中阿含经》卷四十七的《瞿昙弥经》，二十杂阿含经卷四十八的一千两百八十四经，二十一所见，也教奴婢及贫穷的人们发起布施的欢喜心，解除了心灵的贫穷，就能面对物质的贫穷而不以为苦。布施又名造福业，增益阿含经卷十二的三宝品说有三种福业。二十二，第一种布施福业，便是对沙门、婆罗门及贫穷者、病受者、孤独魔所依靠者，应施与衣被、床具、饮食、医药、止宿处等。在大乘经中，又称布施为众福田，例如《优婆塞戒经》所说，以供养三宝为敬田，以孝养父母为恩田， 以不失贫苦为悲田。二十三，不过布施的项目可分三等，那就是一般人只能以财物和劳力布施。P 六二，知解佛法的人可用离苦得乐的观念和方法布施。三，菩萨则能以大无畏的精神布施。财物和劳力的布施，可救一时的急难困苦，离苦得乐的观念及方法，乃是一劳永逸而标本兼治的教育和训练。因此，《增益阿含经》卷七的《有五品》要说：师中之上者，不过法师；业中之上者，不过法业；恩中之上者，所谓不过法恩也。二十四，此即是说，诸布施中，法布施最上；诸供养中，法供养最好；一切恩惠中，法的恩惠最可贵。若以通俗的说法，即是布施物力资源和人力资源，当然很好。若能以教育来训练大众，能使大众获得自立谋生的观念和技巧，那就更好了。五，临终关怀。对于病患的看护以及临终的关怀，已是现代宗教重要的服务项目。现代人病重时，便可能住进医院的病房，接受专业的医护照料，但在病危弥留之际，病患者本人以及病患者的亲属都会陷入恐慌、焦急、悲苦、无奈的情景中。此时即需要给予宗教信仰和宗教精神的照顾，所以从二十世纪末期及于西方社会中，有人设置安宁病房，以照顾临终的病患。我们台湾佛教界也普遍地推出了临终助念的风气，直到目前为止，法鼓山推广的临终关怀及佛化奠基，已经是很受社会大众欢迎的了。其实，此在释迦世尊时代就已实施了的，例如《增益阿含经》卷五《入道品》之四，佛告诸比丘：其有瞻视病者，则为瞻视我矣；有看病者，则为看我矣。所以然者，我今公欲看视疾病。二十五，这是说，比丘们当为病比丘做看护，就等于为佛陀做看护，照顾了病人，就如同照顾了佛陀，而佛陀自己也要亲身看顾病人。故在《僧之律》卷二十八中，就有佛陀亲自替病比丘洗衣的记载。二十六，在《杂阿含经》卷三十七的一千零二十五经记载，有一位克莱比丘在克僧房中病得很重，无人照顾，佛陀便去探看他。病比丘见佛陀来探视，便扶床欲起。P 七，佛陀说：“习卧勿起。”并问他：“苦患您可忍否？”病比丘回说：“我年幼稚，出家未久，于过人法圣妙之见，未有所得。我作是念：命中之时，知身何处，故身便毁。”接着佛陀为他说六根、六尘、六识的原生之理。佛陀走开之后，病比丘便死了。弟子问佛：“如是比丘当身何处？”佛答：“闻我说法，分明解了于法无畏的涅槃。一个出家未久的年轻比丘， 本来还在担心他尚未得到解脱道的圣妙法，不知死后将生何处而生起不安之心。由于佛陀为他临终说法，他变得涅槃正圣果了。27，以此可知，为临终者说法，以及欲临终者应当闻法的重要性了。也有病重比丘，由于佛陀的探视，闻佛说法而病好了的，例如《杂阿含经》卷37的1024经，佛为病重的阿湿波士 （Asage） 尊者说五蕴非我，便使他心得解脱，欢喜踊跃，生病力除。28，在《杂阿含经》卷37中，尚有不少佛及圣弟子们探病说法的例子。29，在《增益阿含经》卷49的《非常品》中，有一则舍利弗与阿难共去探视宾奇长者病的记载，向此长者劝修念佛、念法、念比丘僧，说色、声、香、味、触、离于时，说五蕴炽甚苦，说十二因缘法。长者闻法，感动悲泣，命终之后，即生于33天。30，依据《杂阿含经》卷47的1244经记载，佛说若有男子女人，临寿终时，身遭苦患，众苦畜生，只要心中意念，先前所修的善法功德，即于此时攀缘善法，则当生于善趣，不堕恶趣。31，但亦最好能有善知识从旁劝勉提醒，使得临命中人保持正念。由上所举经证可知，佛教非常重视探看病人，尤其对于病重病危的病人，应该为他说法。或可由于闻法心开而病就好了，或可由于闻法解了而命中解脱，至少也可由于闻法往生善趣，不堕恶趣。中国的净土念佛法门确实是好，不仅能够做临终时的助念关怀，也能够做死亡后的诵念超度，较之于阿含经的临终关怀更多一项方便。诵经说法与念佛说法是异曲同工的。三、21世纪修行观念。佛教的修行观主要是以解脱道为着眼的，也就是从认知四圣谛的苦、苦集、苦灭。P8，而修灭苦之道，这是佛法的根本思想和基本功能。修灭苦之道，便是解脱道。若以修行解脱道而为自己完成灭苦的目的，称为自利行。若以解脱道协助他人也都完成灭苦的目的，称为利他行。近代的日本学者与井柏寿博士的《佛教梵论》也基于这个观点，以小乘诸派为自利教，大乘诸宗为利他教。我一向以为，关怀人间的种种社会问题，是属于人天善法自求出离的四谛法门，称为解脱道，以六度及四摄等法门来利人利己的，称为菩萨道。如果不以解脱道为终极目标，仅修人天善法，从事社会关怀，变成随顺世俗的福利事业，不合佛法救世的宗旨。如果只顾修行四圣谛法而自求解脱，变成缺少慈悲心的自勒汉，不合佛陀说法化世的本怀。必须将出离生死之苦 证的涅槃之乐的解脱法门，结合了人天善法的社会关怀，落实于人间，分享给大众，才是正确的修行观念。大乘佛教贬斥小乘，正因为小乘偏于自求解脱，不合佛陀的本怀，如果佛陀也偏于自求解脱，世间就不会有佛教，我们也不会听闻到佛法了。小乘人仅注意到佛陀所说的四圣谛、十二因缘、八正道品、三十七道品等修持解脱道的道品次第及其果位次第，却忽略了佛陀是为关怀人间大众的种种苦难，疏解人间大众的种种苦难而修道、成道、弘道的。此由佛陀的一生事迹可以看出，佛陀本人便是最具体的大乘精神的亲身示范者。所以在《阿含经》中，就处处呈现了人间性的大乘佛法。何况，大乘佛法的六度及四摄，早在《增益阿含经》及《杂阿含经》中就已见到了。大乘菩萨的利他行，不论六度或四摄，皆以布施为首要，解脱道的道品次第，虽是以戒定慧的三无漏学为纲要，但是佛陀随时随处鼓励财布施及法布施，在家居士通常以财物布施，出家沙门即以自己所学所修的佛法布施。这就是将人天善法的社会关怀提升到与解脱道结合的菩萨道的层次了。这也正是《增益阿含经》之所以要强调法师与财师的两种布施，施中之上者不过法师了。布施而有亲疏厚薄或有目标企图者，称为有相布施，人属于人天善法，布施而无亲疏厚薄，亦无目标企图者，称为无相布施，便是与解脱道相应的菩萨行了。故在《增益阿含经》卷四《护心品》第五经的记载，有一位阿那宾持长者，常作平等布施，不减对象。佛陀便称赞他说：“善哉，善哉，长者，汝乃以菩萨心专精一意而广会师。”又说：“菩萨之学处，恒以平等心而以会师。”三十二《增益阿含经》卷四十五中，亦有佛陀赞叹狮子长者是菩萨所施心恒平等的记载。三十三，于此可知，菩萨行的布施与人天善行的布施，看来相似，其实全异。一般的慈善救济，人为世俗法，若有解脱道的无相或平等心为导向的慈悲救苦，便是菩萨行了。 P 九，因此，新世纪的修行观必须回归到佛陀的本怀，那就是契合社会大众的需求，提升布施的精神层次，落实于解脱道及菩萨道的普遍推广。如果是没有解脱道的菩萨行，其实只是世俗化的人天善法。如果脱离了人天善法而光修解脱之道，那就背离了佛陀应化人间的宗旨。至于什么才是菩萨道的修行法门，在《杂阿含经》卷二十第五百五十经记载，有摩诃迦瞻延尊者向诸比丘所说的五句话：如来说一成道，尽诸众生，离诸恼苦， 忧悲熄灭的真如法。34。这虽出于一项被认为是小乘经典的《杂阿含经》，确实就是大乘菩萨道的根本。此处的一乘道，可以说即是《法华经》的唯一佛乘。35。是和《增益阿含经》卷24等处所见的三圣之道相对而说的。36。一乘道是助一切众生脱离一切的恼苦忧悲，并且实证真如的如实法性，也就是用一乘的佛法嫉度一切众生，净化心地，实证真如。三圣之道是指声闻缘觉佛的圣道次第。至于如何修证，必须如法修行四圣谛、十二因缘、37道品。四圣谛的道圣谛即是八正道，它的基本内容是正见、正行、正定、正智慧，也就是以佛陀本怀的正知见作为实践戒、定、慧三无漏学的指导方针，来清净身语意的三业行为，持戒安身，修定摄心，依空慧而得解脱。阿含经中的解脱有两种人，一者定慧具解脱，二则慧解脱。中国禅宗第六祖慧能大师的《坛经》之中，则主张定慧一体，不是二，定是慧体，慧是定用。37。又说外离相未禅，内部乱未定。38。若能于日常生活中，但的心不染着，不起恼乱者，便是自在解脱之人。如何能够做到？一般人还是得从布施、持戒、习定方面多下功夫，方能开业消而证真如法性。四，我们正在朝向新世纪的佛教努力。21世纪的佛教必须落实于社会问题的关怀，如果光是藏身于自我封闭的修道生活，佛教将会遭受被时代社会淘汰而招致灭亡的命运。但是关怀社会是为社会大众减轻痛苦，增加幸福，提升品质，而不是随波逐流，被世俗同化。P10。我们法鼓山是在救人首要安心的原则下，依据《维摩经》所说随其心净则国土净。39的教士提倡心灵环保，用禅修的观念和方法来提升人的品质，以其普遍推广而来完成建设人间净土的理念。我们以教育工作来完成关怀的任务，又以关怀工作达成教育的目的。我们法鼓山正在做的，将要做的，就是为了回归佛陀的本怀。我们自从中华佛学研究所召开的第一届国际佛学会议以来，已经集思广益，得到了许多学者们提供的伟论高见，对法鼓山有用，对全球的佛教有用，对全人类的离苦得乐有用。不过法鼓山的团体很小，力量有限，想做的很多，有能力做到，做好的不多，可是我们应该有信心，21世纪的佛教徒们都会共同响应，共同努力的。为大会的成功祝福，为佛教对人间社会的关怀祝福，为一切众生能因佛法的救济而离苦得乐祝福。 2002年1月18日讲于中央研究院学术活动中心。Buddhism in the 21st century, its social function and view of practice keynote address for the opening ceremony of the 4th Changhua International Conference on Buddhism. Fan Shen Yan, founder, Changhua Institute of Buddhist Studies. P11. Introduction. It had already been 12 years since the Changhua Institute of Buddhist Studies held its first international conference on Buddhism at the National Central Library in Taipei from January 12-15, 1990. At that time we determined a permanent theme, the Buddhist tradition and modern society. Accordingly, the topics chosen for discussion at the first three conferences were Buddhist ethics and modern society, traditional Buddhist precepts and the modern world, and the earthly Pure Land and contemporary society. At each, many outstanding scholars presented papers of high quality. Now at this fourth conference, we will keep to our permanent theme and discuss the role of Buddhism in the 21st century. We have invited more than 40 outstanding contemporary scholars of Buddhism from 11 countries and regions including the Republic of China, Mainland China, Thailand, the United Kingdom, the United States, India, Canada, Japan, Russia, Germany and South Korea to present more than 30 splendid papers. I would like to express my respect and gratitude first to all the scholars gathered here for the fruits of research and wise counsel you are going to present for the well-being of humanity in the 21st century. This conference will have three subtopics comprising three spheres. These are Buddhism in daily life, Buddhism in society, and Buddhism in the information age. In each sphere, many specialized papers will be presented. This keynote address of mine will engage in a retrospective and prospective discussion based on the gamut, A. Han. P12. Jing, from only two approaches, Buddhism in daily life and Buddhism in society. I offer this in the hope of stimulating instructive comments from all of you here today. As for the third subtopic, Professor Louis Lancaster will deliver a separate keynote address for us. Buddhism is fundamentally a religion that emphasizes social concern. Religion is a social phenomenon and Buddhism is no exception. Although it has been over 2,500 years since the passing away of the Buddha, as of old Buddhism still has an extremely important mission in human society. One may even say that the world today and in the future will need the wisdom and methods of Buddhism more and more to solve the social problems of humanity. In the following, I will discuss five social issues from the perspective of the Gamas, explaining the Buddhist stance and the solutions Buddhism may offer. 1. Equal human rights. Modern society must be established on the foundation of equal human rights. In ancient Indian society, which was comprised of four varna or castes, this idea was not accepted. However, in the Dhammas preached by the Buddha, he was already advocating the equality of the castes. For instance, in the Song Ahangjing Madhyamagama, Fascicle 39, Fancy Chapter, the Buddha discourses to a Brahmin on the equality of the four castes, and the Yuki Sijing of the Song Ahangjing, Fascicle 59, Li Chapter, in which the Buddha discourses to King Prasenajit on the problem of caste, also ends with the king concluding that the castes should be equal. 2. In the Za Ahangjing, Saunitgama, Fascicle 44, there is a verse that says, "Do not ask of someone's birth but of his actions. Fire may be produced by the friction of boring wood. A muni with steadfast character may be P13 produced from among the low castes. 3. This is to say that a sage may be born in the low castes. In the Zenji Ahangjing, Ekhotarikama, Fascicle 37, it says, "In my teaching, when people from the four castes become Rammas, their former names are not recorded, still less any other terms. It is like the sea, though all four great rivers empty into it, it tastes of a single flavor without any other name." 4. The Xia Yuanjing of the Chang Ahangjing, Drukgama, Fascicle 6, records that the Buddha said, "If people ask you what caste are you, you should reply, 'I am a Rama, the son of the Kaya clan.'" 5. This means that the belief in a class or caste system is not reasonable. To appraise a person's accomplishment and nobility, one should examine the morality in the person's conduct and the level of the person's wisdom rather than examining his or her family or caste background. So all those renunciants in the Buddha's community could give up their original caste status and be known together as Kramana, sons of Kaya. Even householders who follow the Buddha's path were no longer judged higher or lower based on their caste status, but were all measured by the virtuous deeds they had done. This plainly broke with the unequal class system and placed people of every caste and ethnic group on equal social footing. For Indian society of the time, this was nothing less than a revolutionary human rights movement. 2. Church, state separation. The separation of church and state is an inevitable trend of the new P14 era. If not, the linkage between the political system and religious organizations may lead political figures to manipulate the believing masses and give rise to a crisis of corruption and secularization for religious communities. Moreover, Politicians will often incite the religious masses to launch a religious war for their own personal interests. So Orthodox Buddhists will never be drawn into the whirlpool of politics. For instance, in the Zenji Ahongjin, Fascicle 42, Jijin Chapter, there is a rule that Pixus may not become close to kings lest there occur 10 problems, disadvantageous to the Pixu and harmful to the Buddhist community. 6. The Dekongjin of the Zong Ahongjin, Fascicle 49, says that Kremenas should not discuss kings, rebels, strife, and so on. 7. In the Zenji Ahongjin, Fascicle 43, Shani Chapter, the Buddha says to the Pixus, do not praise or disparage a king as governance of his realm, and do not discuss which king is superior or inferior. 8. This is because Buddhism is borderless, nonpartisan, and disapproves of involvement in political conflict. However, it is not that Buddhism does not care whether the country is governed well or poorly. If one meets a virtuous king or prime minister, one should give him timely advice. For instance, 3 separate sutras, the Yushijing of the Zong Ahongjin, Fascicle 35, the Yuxingjing of the Chang Ahongjin, Fascicle 20, and the Qri chapter of the Zenji Ahongjin, Fascicle 34, 11, all lay forth the 7 teachings for governing a nation. Basically, these teachings exhort diligent governance and love of the people and discussion of national affairs with a mind of harmony by kings and ministers. Further, they exhort solidarity of the people, peaceful interaction between those of high and low status, respect for the opinions of the elderly, observance of etiquette or established customs, upright implementation of the law, reverence for religion, and respectful making of offerings. So we should employ religion to bless the nation and people and to settle people as minds, and employ politics to govern the country, to protect the people, and to uphold religion. Buddhist monastics in any nation are patriotic, they care about politics, but do not seek to manipulate it. As to lay Buddhists, they not only care about politics but should also participate. They must not, however, use the religious community as a political tool. 7. Religious tolerance. Cultural diversity and religious tolerance are already an inevitable trend of the new civilization. America's contemporary might originates in the emigration to the New World of the Puritans, whom the conservative 17th century England could not tolerate. Hence, part of the founding spirit of America is the people as freedom of religion, which guarantees religious tolerance and diversity. Actually, the Buddha, in his time, already frequently admonished his disciples to respectfully make offerings equally to Kremanas and Brahmins of all religions. For example, in the Chang'anjing fascicle 2, Yuxingjing, he suggests that a king, in ruling his country, should pay homage to temples and give respect to the spirits and deities just as he would filially serve his parents and respectfully obey his teachers and elders. 12. In the Zhangjiahongjing, Fascicle 34, Chri Chapter, he encourages the people of Virje to make offerings to Kramanas and Brahmins and to politely serve and pay respect to all Brahma, Karins. 13. That is to say that everyone should have religious faith and serve and make offerings to religious teachers and practitioners, but needn't necessarily believe in Buddhism. Also in the Zhongahongjing, Fascicle 32, Yupoli Jing, and Moving Story. P. 16. Is told. 14. A person who had originally followed the outer path of Nyagrantha, Jataputra, P. Nigaha, Putta, accepted the Buddha's teaching. Afterwards he intended to stop allowing the teachers of this outer path into his home and to stop making offerings to them. The Buddha found out, and yet he encouraged the lay person to continue making offerings as before, saying, householder, this I did not say, give to me and not to him, give to my disciples and not to his. Householder, give to all at your heart as pleasure. Householder, as for Nyagrantha, Jataputra, whom your family have revered so long, if he comes, make such offerings to him as you are able to. 15. Buddhism holds that every religion should receive protection and respect as long as they do not contradict the virtuous teachings of the human and heavenly vehicles. But I must tell you, although Buddhism holds the virtuous teachings of the human and heavenly vehicles to be fundamental, it does not hold them to be ultimate. Above them, there is still the path of liberation from birth and death, the Bodhisattva path of awakening oneself and others, and the unexcelled enlightenment of Anattara, Samyak, Sambuddhi. Buddhism is a religion that supports seeking common ground while preserving differences, so it is able to accept other cultures and even use their good points to spread Buddhism. It is not like exclusivist, dichotomous religions that view the religions of other peoples and cultures as demonic faiths that must be destroyed. This view has created great religious and racial feuds and enmity, cycles of revenge, and endless mutual slaughter. In the global village of the new century, groups like the Taliban, the radical Islamic exclusivists who ruled Afghanistan since 1996 until recently, will inevitably be isolated. P. 17. By the tide of history and lose their space for survival. If not, the fate of human society will be a great tragedy. 4. Social welfare. The Bodhisattva spirit of entering the world to save it has become the inevitable road that contemporary religions must take. Actually, after the Buddha attained enlightenment, with the exception of the 3 months of the yearly rainy season retreat, the Buddha led his disciples out almost every day to travel amongst the people preaching the Dharma, caring for their sufferings, spreading the word of the path to liberation from suffering, and encouraging them to resolve to work for the benefit of sentient beings. In the Zenji Ahongjing, Fascicle 11, Paikara Buddha speaks on the practices of a Bodhisattva, 16, and in the 19th fascicle of the same sutra Maitreya Bodhisattva requests a teaching on the 6 premises. 17. Moreover, Sutras 667 and 669 of the Za Ahongjing, Fascicle 26, clearly mention the 4 methods of inducement. 18. The 6 perfections and 4 methods of inducement are usually thought of as belonging to the Mahayana Dharma, gate of the Bodhisattva, yet they can already be seen in the Gamas. Among the 6 perfections, giving benefits others and keeping precepts seems to benefit only oneself. Yet the 5 precepts are also called the 5 great acts of giving, and the precepts to keep include the Bodhisattva's 3 sets of pure precepts, so keeping precepts also benefits others. The 4 inducements are giving, speaking lovingly, acting beneficially, and intermingling, which are all expedient means for benefiting others. Throughout the Gamas, the Buddha's disciples are encouraged to practice giving. This is the Buddhist view of social welfare. Because people's intelligence and karmic blessings are not the same, their productive and management abilities are not the same, and especially P18. Their opportunities are not the same. Thus a gap between rich and poor opens naturally. If we resort to some institutional means to evenly distribute property, that would be unfair and irrational. If we lay down hard rules, perhaps everyone will be equally poor rather than equally rich. Besides a rational economic system, the best method of solving the social problem of large economic disparity is to encourage people to give willingly and readily. And what shall one give? The Zenji Ahongjing, Fascicle 27, Xiaju Chapter, says, again, there are 5 acts of giving that lead to great blessings. What are the 5? The first is to create a park, the second a grove, the third a bridge, the fourth a vessel, and the fifth a dwelling for those who pass by in the future. 19. These 5 parks, forests, bridges, ships, and hostels are all public facilities for the use of all. In today's society, they are now mostly the undertakings of the government, but there are still some welfare that the government fails to provide, but can be provided through the people's private giving. For instance, everyone should extend a helping hand to displaced, homeless disaster victims and refugees, as well as those stricken by poverty, sickness, cold, and hunger by providing them with food, clothing and medicine, and by teaching them methods and techniques to make a living. We should even, as can be seen in the Zhong Ahangjing, Fascicle 47, Jutan Maijing 20, and Sutra 1284 of the Za Ahangjing, Fascicle 48, 21, teach the enslaved and the poor to give rise to the joyous mind of giving. When one eliminates spiritual poverty, one can face material poverty without being distressed. Giving is also called an activity which creates blessings. In the Zenji Ahangjing, Fascicle 12, Sanbao chapter, it says that there are P19, three kinds of activities which create blessings. 22, the first is giving, which is providing clothing, bedding, food, medicine, and lodging to Kramanas, Brahmins, the destitute, the sick and emaciated, and those who are helpless and alone. In the Mahayana Sutras, giving is also called sowing the fields of merit. For instance, the Yupo Saiji Jing says making offerings to the three jewels is sowing the merit field of reverence, filially caring for one as parents is sowing the merit field of gratitude, and giving to those suffering poverty and hardship is sowing the merit field of compassion. 23. Giving may be divided into three levels. Most can only give property and labor. Those with an understanding of the Dharma can give the views and methods for leaving suffering and attaining happiness, and a Bodhisattva can give others the spirit of fearlessness. Gifts of material goods and labor can save one from temporary emergencies and hardships, while the views and methods for leaving suffering and gaining happiness is a form of education and training which may solve the problem once and for all. Thus in the Zenji Ahangjing, Fascicle 7, Yu Wu chapter, it says, among the higher forms of giving, none surpasses giving the Dharma. Among the higher forms of deeds, none surpasses deeds of the Dharma. Among the higher forms of beneficence, none surpasses the beneficence of the Dharma. 24. This is to say, among all forms of giving, the gift of the Dharma is supreme. Among all forms of offering, the offering of the Dharma is best. Among all forms of favors, the favor of giving the Dharma is most precious. To put it colloquially, of course gifts of material and human. P20. Resources are good, but if you can teach people ideas and methods to support themselves, that is even better. 5. End of life care. Nursing the sick and providing care for the dying are now important services of a modern religion. When people these days become seriously ill, they may be hospitalized to receive professional medical care. But on their deathbed, The patients themselves and their family members often fall into a state of panic, apprehension, sorrow, and helplessness. Religious and spiritual care is urgently needed at such times. Therefore, starting in the second half of the 20th century, people in Western societies have been establishing hospice wards to care for the dying. In Taiwan, we in Buddhist circles have also popularized the custom of deathbed chanting assistance, and today, the end of life care and Buddhist style funeral services promoted by Dharmadrong Mountain Buddhist Association have become very popular with the public. Actually, similar things were already done in the time of Kayamuni Buddha. For instance, in the Zenji Ahongjin, Fascicle 5, Rudeo Chapter, Section 4, the Buddha tells his bhikkhus, "Whoever visits the sick has visited me, whoever takes care of the sick has taken care of me." Why is this so? Because I myself want to care for the sick. 25. This means when the bhikkhus nurse a sick companion, it is equivalent to nursing the Buddha. That is, caring for the sick is the same as caring for the Buddha, as the Buddha himself also wished to personally look after the sick. Therefore, in the Mosaika Vinaya, Fascicle 28, it is recorded that the Buddha once washed clothes for a sick bhikkhu. 26. And the Zia Ahongjin, Fascicle 37, Sutra 1025, records that a visiting P21 bhikkhu staying in the guest room was struck by a serious illness, and he had no one to care for him. So the Buddha went to visit him, and when the sick bhikkhu saw the Buddha, he tried to push himself up from his bed. But the Buddha told him, "Continue lying down and resting, do not rise," and asked him, "Are you able to endure the suffering?" The sick bhikkhu responded, "I am still young and have not been a monk for long. I still have not achieved wondrous and transcendent insight. I ponder, where will I be reborn after death? And I feel remorse." Then the Buddha gave him a discourse on the conditioned arising of the six sense organs, six sense objects, and six consciousnesses. After the Buddha left, the bhikkhu died. The Buddha's disciples asked him, "Where will that bhikkhu be reborn?" The Buddha answered, "When he listened to my discourse, he achieved keen understanding, gained unshakable confidence in the Dharma, and entered parinirvana." Because the Buddha gave him a Dharma talk on his deathbed, a young bhikkhu who had only recently left home, and who was originally worried because he had not achieved the supreme insight of the path of liberation, and didn't he know where he would be reborn after death, instantly achieved the noble fruit of nirvana. 27. From this, we can see the importance of preaching the Dharma to those approaching death, and the importance for those about to die to listen to the Dharma. There are also cases of sick bhikkhus who, because of the Buddha's visit, recovered from their illnesses. For example, in the Ca Ahangjing, Fascicle 37, Sutra 1024, the Buddha gives a discourse on five aggregates are not self to the Venerable Akvahit, PSAG, which leads the Venerable to liberation of mind, great joy, and the instant disappearance of his illness. 28. Furthermore, in other places in the Ca Ahangjing, Fascicle 37, there are many instances of the Buddha and his noble disciples visiting the sick and preaching the Dharma to them. 29. The Zenji Ahangjing, Fascicle 49, Feichen Chapter, gives an account of Karaputra and Ananda visiting the sick elder and Piada, Pianathapindika. 30. They advised the elder to contemplate the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha of Bhikkhus, and they discoursed on detaching consciousness from visual, auditory, olfactory, gustatory, and tactile sensations, on the suffering of the five burning aggregates, and on the 12 links of conditioned arising. As the elder heard the discourse, he was moved to weep, and after dying he was reborn in the heaven of the 33. According to the Ca Ahangjing, Fascicle 47, Sutra 1244, the Buddha tells that if there is any man or woman who, while facing death, experiences all kinds of physical agony, they need only recollect the meritorious practices they have cultivated in life. Then their minds will hold on to good thoughts, and they will be reborn in a happy destiny. 31. But still it is best if the dying are accompanied by a spiritual friend who can remind them to maintain right mindfulness. From the sutras cited above, we see that Buddhism places much importance on visiting and caring for the sick, emphasizing especially that we should preach the Dharma to the critically ill. By listening to the Dharma, some can be cured, others die but can gain insight and be liberated from samsara, and others are at least able to be reborn in a happy destiny and avoid falling into the miserable ones. The Chinese Pure Land practice of reciting Amitabha Buddha's name is certainly a good method. It can be used not only to care for the dying and help maintain their right mindfulness, but also to help the deceased be reborn in a good realm of existence, thus, beyond the end of life care application. It has an additional function. These two Dharma, preaching practices, chanting sutras and reciting Amitabha Buddha's name, though they differ in method, actually have the same function. P23. 3. Buddhist view of practice in the 21st century. The Buddhist view of practice focuses primarily on the path of liberation, which means first to understand the noble truths of suffering, the origin of suffering, and the cessation of suffering, and then to cultivate the path leading to the cessation of suffering. These comprise the fundamental philosophy and function of Buddhism. Cultivating the way leading to the cessation of suffering is the path of liberation. If one cultivates the path of liberation solely to end suffering for oneself, this is called the self-benefiting practice. If, on the other hand, one follows the path of liberation to help others also achieve the cessation of suffering, this is called the altruistic practice. The modern Japanese scholar Drui Hakuji in his book Bukihenren, An Outline of Buddhism, takes this perspective and regards the various Hnena schools as the self-benefiting teachings and the various Mahayana schools as the altruistic teachings. I have always held this view. Caring for the various social problems of humanity is a virtuous practice of the human and heavenly vehicles, seeking to leave behind suffering for oneself through the Four Noble Truths is the path of liberation, and helping others and oneself through the six perfections and four methods of inducement is the bodhisattva path. If we do not take liberation as the ultimate goal, and merely practice the teachings of the human and heavenly vehicles by caring for society, then such practice is no different from secular welfare work, inconsistent with the Buddhist aim to liberate sentient beings from samsara. If we just practice the Four Noble Truths and seek personal liberation, then we become self-serving people lacking in kindness and compassion, which is counter to the Buddha's original intention of transforming the world by spreading the Dharma. So we must combine the path of liberation, which leads us out of samsara to attain the bliss of nirvana, with the loving concern for society expressed in the teachings of the human and heavenly vehicles. We must then carry out the teachings in the world and share the benefits we gain with others. This is the truly correct approach to practice. Mahayana Buddhism criticizes Hnena because they one-sidedly seek personal liberation, which does not conform to the Buddha's original intention. If the Buddha had also been seeking primarily personal liberation, then we would not have Buddhism in this world, and we would not hear the Buddha Dharma. Hnena only pay attention to the Four Noble Truths, 12 links of conditioned arising, Eightfold Noble Path, 37 aids to enlightenment as preached by the Buddha, and to the order of these graduated practices and fruits of attainment on the liberation path. Yet they neglect that the Buddha practiced, attained enlightenment, and preached the Dharma because he felt concern for all people, and because he wanted to alleviate all their sufferings. We can see from the Buddha's life that the Buddha himself was a most clear exemplar of the Mahayana spirit, which is why the Gemas are full of humanistic Mahayana Buddha Dharma. For example, The Mahayana teachings of the six perfections and four methods of inducement can already be seen in both the Zhangji Ahangjing and Za Ahangjing. The altruistic practice of Mahayana Bodhisattvas, whether it be the six perfections or the four methods of inducement, begins with the principal practice of giving. And although the graduated system of practices of the liberation path has the three undefiled practices of precepts, concentration, and wisdom at its heart, the Buddha nevertheless frequently encouraged people to give both possessions and Dharma teachings. Lay people usually gave property, whereas monastics would give the Buddha Dharma they had learned and practiced. This giving of the Dharma exemplifies raising the social concern of the human and heavenly vehicles to the level of the Bodhisattva path through integration with the path of liberation. This is exactly why the Zhangji Ahangjing, in discussing these two types of giving, emphasizes that among the higher forms of giving, none surpasses the giving of the Dharma. Giving in which the giver varies the amount given according to his relationship with the recipient, or in which the giver harbors some ulterior motives, is called conditioned giving, which still falls within the scope of the human and heavenly vehicles. When such discrimination and motives are not present, giving is called unconditioned, and becomes a bodhisattva practice that is in concordance with the path of liberation. So the Zhangji Ahangjing, Fascicle 4, Huixin Chapter, Sutra 5, recounts how the elder Anathapindada practiced impartial giving, without discriminating the recipients. The Buddha praised him, saying, well done, elder. With the mind of a bodhisattva, you practice extensive giving single-mindedly. He also said that the place of learning for a bodhisattva is to be always impartial in practicing giving. 32. And in the Zhangji Ahangjing, Fascicle 45, the Buddha commends the elder Simha for his views, saying, when a bodhisattva gives, he always gives impartially. 33. From this we can see that giving of the bodhisattva vehicle and giving of the human and heavenly vehicles appear similar but are in fact entirely different. Ordinary charity work is still a mundane practice, whereas compassionate suffering relief efforts guided by marklessness and impartiality of the liberation path is a bodhisattva practice. Therefore, our approach to practice in the new century must return to the Buddha's original intention, that is, to meet the needs of people in society, to elevate the spiritual quality of our giving, and to extensively promote the liberation and bodhisattva paths. Bodhisattva practices without the goal of liberation are merely practices of the worldly, human and heavenly vehicles. But if we depart from the 26. teachings of the human and heavenly vehicles and merely cultivate the path to liberation, then we deviate from the Buddha's purpose in manifesting in the world to save sentient beings. Then what exactly are the practices of the Bodhisattva path? The Zhaohongjing, Fascicle 20, Sutra 550, records the Venerable Moktayana, Pimoakna, speaking the following words to the Bhikkhus. The one vehicle path is preached by the Tathagata to purify sentient beings and to help them leave behind all afflictions, eliminate all worries and sorrows, and attain the Dharma of suchness. 34. Although this passage appears in the Zhaohongjing, which has always been considered a Hnana Sutra, it is nevertheless the very root of the Bodhisattva path of the Mahayana. The one vehicle path mentioned here can be identified with the one Buddha vehicle in the Lotus Sutra, 35, and this path is presented in contrast to the paths of the three vehicles referred to in the Zhaohongjing, Fascicle 24, 36, as well as in other places. This one vehicle path is to help all sentient beings leave behind all afflictions, sufferings, worries and sorrows, and realize suchness, the true nature of dharmas. In other words, it is to use the one vehicle Buddha Dharma to deliver all sentient beings, purify their minds, and help them realize suchness. The paths of the three vehicles refer to the noble paths of the Vaka, Pratyeka, Buddha, and Buddha. And how should one practice to attain realization? One must practice in accordance with the teachings of the Four Noble Truths, 12 links of dependent arising, and 37 aids to enlightenment. The fourth of the Four Noble Truths is the Eightfold Noble Path, whose basic content is right view, right action, right concentration, and right wisdom. This means one takes the knowledge. P27. An insight achieved by the Buddha for guidance in practicing the three undefiled practices of precepts, concentration, and wisdom, so as to purify actions of the body, speech and mind. Keeping precepts pacifies the body, practicing concentration collects the mind, and relying on the wisdom of emptiness leads to liberation. In the Gemas, two kinds of liberated practitioners are mentioned, those liberated through both concentration and wisdom, and those liberated through wisdom alone. In the Platform Sutra, however, Master Huinen, the sixth patriarch of the Chan school, claims that concentration and wisdom are one, not two. Concentration is the substance of wisdom, and wisdom is the function of concentration. 37. He further says that to be detached from outward marks is Chan. To be free from inward disturbance is concentration. 38. If in daily life you can keep your mind free of defilements and vexations, then you are a free and liberated person. How can this be achieved? Well, ordinary people still need to make more efforts in such aspects as giving, keeping precepts and cultivating concentration, so that they can one day open their minds, eliminate karma, and thereby realize suchness. 四. We are striving toward a Buddhism of the new century. Buddhism in the 21st century must root itself in concern for social problems. If Buddhists only shut themselves away in the cloister, Buddhism will be eliminated by contemporary society and eventually meet extinction. But Buddhists' care for society should be aimed at helping everyone reduce suffering, increase happiness, and uplift their character. It surely does not mean drifting with the tide and becoming assimilated by worldly ways. On the principle that, in helping people, we must first bring them peace of mind and in accordance with the Vimalakirtisutras. P28. Teaching that when the mind is pure, the land will be pure. 39. We at Dharmadrong Mountain have been advocating spiritual environmentalism, using the concepts and methods of Chan practice to uplift the character of humanity. We do this with an eye to popularizing and carrying out our vision to build a pure land on earth. We complete our mission of social concern through education, and achieve our goal of education through social concern. What we at Dharmadrong Mountain are doing and will do is all to return to the Buddha's original intention. Since the Changhua Institute of Buddhist Studies held the first international conference on Buddhism, through the pooling of all participants' ideas, we have gained many valuable thoughts from distinguished scholars. These ideas are useful for Dharmadrong Mountain, useful for Buddhism worldwide, and useful for all humanity to leave behind suffering and attain true happiness. However, the Dharmadrong Mountain community is small, and our resources limited. We want to do so much, yet the number of things we can truly accomplish is small. But we should have confidence that Buddhists in the 21st century will all respond in unison and work together. May the conference be a success. May Buddhism as care for human society be realized. May all sentient beings be delivered through the Buddha Dharma, leave behind suffering, and attain true happiness. January 18, 2002, Auditorium of Academic Activity Center, Academia Sinica. 一大正藏册一页648上。二大正藏册一页792下。三大正藏册二页320下。四大正藏册二页753上。五大正藏册一页37上中。六大正藏册二页775下。七大正藏册一页739上。八大正藏册二页782下。九大正藏册一页648上。十大正藏 侧一页十一上。十一大正藏侧二页七百三十五中。十二大正藏侧一页十一上。十三大正藏侧二页七百三十五中。十四大正藏侧一页六百二十八上。十五大正藏侧一页六百三十中。十六大正藏侧二页五百九十九上。十七大正藏侧二页六百四十五中。十八大正藏侧二页一百八十四下一百八十五上。十九大正藏侧二页六百九十九上。二十大正藏侧一页七百二十一下。二十一大正藏侧二页三百五十三中。二十二大正藏侧二页六百零一下。二十三大正藏侧二十四页一千零三十四。二十四大正藏侧二页五百七十七中。二十五大正藏侧二页五百六十九下。二十六大正藏侧二十二页四百五十二上。二十七大正藏侧二页两百六十七下。二十八大正藏侧二页两百六十七中。二十九大正藏侧二页两百六十六下。三十大正藏侧二页八百一十四上。三十一大正藏侧二页三百四十一上。三十二大正藏侧二页五百六十五上。三十三大正藏侧二页七百九十二下。三十四大正藏侧二页一百四十三中。三十五大正藏侧九页七下。三十六大正藏侧二页六百七十四上。三十七大正藏侧四十八页三百五十二下。三十八大正藏侧四十八页三百五十三中。三十九大正藏侧十四页五百三十八下。一 T 一点六四八 A。二 T 一点七九二 C。三 T 二点三二零 C 五年七月。四 T 二点七五三 A 二十三年二月六。五 T 一点三七 A 二十九 Q W B 一六 T 二点七七五 C 七 T 一点七三九 A 二十六年二月七八 T 二点七八二 C 五九 T 一点六四八 A 十 T 一点一一 A 十一 T 二点七三五 B十二 T 一点一一 A 十三 T 二点七三五 B 十四 T 一点六二八 A 十八十五 T 一点六三零 B 十六 T 二点五九九 A 二十三十七 T 二点六四五 B 一十八T 二点一八四 C 丢的一百八十五 A 十九 T 二点六九九 A 十六年一月九二十 T 一点七二一 C 二十二二十一 T 二点三五三 B 二十五